expiration, transportation, excretion, etc. And didn't you feel that all these life processes or all the organ systems in our body are so well designed and intricately designed for its efficiency of function? When all so many systems are present in our body, they need to be coordinated also. Now, when we think of ourselves, we are doing so many activities in our daily life. Simply picking up a pen or taking food into your mouth, all these simple activities need a very good coordination. Don't you agree? So don't you think we need a very efficient control and coordination system also? So today we are going to start with the chapter control and coordination. Okay, just look into the some of the activities we do in the daily life. You know, Tom and Jerry. The Tom is running behind the Jerry to catch it. So if his control and coordination is proper, he would be successful. Similarly, if Jerry is very smart enough, he can escape from him. Driving, you need a very good control and coordination, or else you will be ending up in accidents. Okay. A cricketer, when he hits a ball, if he is not controlling his movements, he might get out. Okay, otherwise he might go for a sixer or four. Yes, when you're crossing a road, you have to be very careful. If you're careless, you will meet with an accident. Even cooking, your mother cooks food at home. There also, if a little bit, if she is becoming careless in some way or the other, if her control and coordination is disrupted in one way or the other, she might get injured in her finger. Okay, so children, coordination of our body is done by two ways, that is a nervous control and the hormonal control. In our body, two systems which are helping in control and coordination is the nervous system and the hormonal system, which is called as an endocrine system, which we'll be learning in the next. Okay, so we are starting with the nervous system. From the word nervous system, it's made up of nerves. So you can see this picture, our body, we have nerves throughout the body. When you go to a dentist to pluck out your teeth, you feel pain because there is nerve. Wherever you get pain, there are nerves in it. When you cut your nails, you do not feel pain. But if someone tries to pluck it out, you get injured, you get pain. That is, nerves are there below your skin. Nerves are present throughout your body because it is sensing the stimuli from the environment. Okay, so when we saw that so many activities are there in our daily life, all these senses has to go into your brain. So we have five types of sense organs to grab the stimuli from the environment. That is done by the five sense organs. Of course, which are the five sense organs? We have the eye, tongue for taste, nose for detecting the smell, ears to hear the sound, and the hands to detect the temperature, touch, etc. So all the five sense organs are helping us to take the stimuli from the environment. So once the stimuli is taken, it has to be carried to your brain, which is the main part of your nervous system. So first thing is, a stimulus from the environment is received by the sense organs. Okay, now these sense organs will be taking it to the brain, but first of all, that capturing of this stimulus is because of certain receptors in the sense organs. Every sense organ has receptor cells in them. The receptor cells of the ear are called phonoreceptors. The receptor cells of the eye is called the photoreceptors. You have learned about rods and cones which are present in the retina. So they are the photoreceptors which are sensing the stimulus from the environment. And then thermoreceptors are in the skin. Olfactory receptors are in the nose, which is helping you to detect the smell. Gustatory receptors are present in the tongue. In your 10th standard textbook, they have mentioned only about the gustatory receptors and the olfactory receptors. Okay, so now the first step was sensing stimulus. It is done by the receptors of the sense organs. After that, it will be carried to the brain. So these are the, you can see these are the nerves which are going towards and away from the brain. You can see the nerves throughout the body. Some nerves will be going towards the brain, some up away from the brain. So it is the nerves which are carrying the messages. So there are two types of nerves. The nerves which are going towards the brain from the sense organ is called as the sensory receptor, or is called as a sensory neuron. Neuron is another name for nerve cell. And those nerves which are bringing messages away from the brain, they are called as the motor nerves. We have two types of nerves, sensory and motor nerves. Here is an example shown. If you have a bottle, if you are very thirsty, you see the bottle of water or a glass of water kept there. So that is detected by the receptors of your eye. So stimulus is received by the receptor from the sense organ. Those messages are going to the brain. Okay, so that nerve is called as a sensory neuron. From the spinal cord, it will go to the brain through the spinal cord. And then from the brain, again back to the spinal cord. Then from the brain, which is coming, that is a motor neuron. So the two types of neurons, the neurons which are moving from the sense organs towards the brain, sensory neuron. The ones which are moving away from the brain are called as the motor neuron. Why the word motor? Motor means muscle. So when the neuron connected to the muscles of your hand, when the messages reaches the muscles of your hand, the hand will pick up the glass of water and you drink it. Clear? So remember the path of the nerve impulse. This is a normal path of the nerve impulse. You're picking up the glass is called as a response. So see the path between the stimulus and the response. Stimulus, seeing the glass of water, receptors of the eye has seen it. It is sent through the sensory nerve to the spinal cord, to the brain, back to the spinal cord. Motor nerves are connected to the muscles of your hand, and then you can see the response you are picking up. Is it clear? If there is a break in any place here, then this messages will not be passed properly. So one of the questions asks, what are the two types of neurons? Okay. Okay. So when we talked about these neurons, okay, if you consider one neuron, this is a structure of one neuron. It's a normal animal cell. You have learned different type of animal cells are present in our body, and their shape is designed as per their function. The neurons are elongated in nature because their function is to transmit the messages in the form of electrical and chemical signals. Okay, now see the structure of the neuron or the nerve cell. It's divided into three parts. This first part is a main cell. It's called as a cell body. Then the cytoplasm of the cell body is extended to form a long structure. This is called as the axon. And the last part is called as a nerve ending or axon terminal. So it is the cell body, axon and the nerve endings. Clear? Now if you observe the cell body, it has branches which is extending from the cytoplasm. These branches are called the dendrites. They will capture the signal. And the signals which are captured from here, it is passed on to the cell body. And from here, it will pass through the axon. But can you see in the axon, there are some covering like this. These coverings are called as myelin sheath. But this myelin sheath is not continuous throughout. There are spaces in between where there is no myelin sheath. So those spaces are called as nodes of Ranvier. Okay, so the messages pass through this elongated structure and reach the last part of the axon, which is called as a nerve ending or the axon terminal. So when you revise the structure, starts from dendrites, then into the cell body, then through the axon, then to the nerve endings. This is just like a normal cell with the nucleus, mitochondria and all other organelles. Clear? So this is the structure of the neuron or nerve cells. You usually get it for the exams to draw. Okay? Now here I have shown you the two neurons. This is the first neuron and this is the second neuron. I told you that the nerve impulses or the signals are passing from the dendrites till the nerve endings. Then it will go to the next neuron. So when it is going from one neuron to another, there is a gap between the two neurons. This is the beginning of the first neuron and this is the end of the first neuron. This is the beginning of the second neuron. So this is a nerve ending and this is the dendrite of the second neuron. Between them, there is a space. It is not directly connected. If this is one neuron, this is one neuron, they are not directly connected. There is a gap between them. That gap is called as the synapse. It is shown here clearly. So you can see this is the axon terminal. That is the nerve ending from here. And this is a dendrite of the next neuron. This is the first neuron, ending of the first neuron. And this is the ending of the starting of the second neuron. Between them you can see some gap. This gap is called as a synapse. Now, how does the message pass? The messages are passed from one nerve through this nerve in the form of electrical signals. Now, what is electrical signals? It is actually sodium and potassium ions. They shift up and down. That you will be learning in the higher classes. It's called shifting potential. All those you will learn in higher classes. For 10th standard, you just remember that it is passing in the form of electrical signals. It reaches the end. Here you can see. As soon as it reaches the end, here because of the gap, that electrical signals will be converted into chemical signals. Why it is called chemical signals? Because it is made up of certain chemicals called neurotransmitters. So you can see, neurotransmitters. Usually it's called acetylcholine. So you remember neurotransmitters, okay? So from here, it will convert into chemical signals and it will cross the gap and it will reach the next neuron. Once it reaches the next neuron, then from here again, it will be that chemical signals will convert back into electrical signals. So how it is going from here? Electrical signals, then synapse, conversion of electrical to chemical, crossing of the gap, then again from chemical to electrical, and the second neuron is going and it will take it to the third neuron and so on. Clear? So if the question is asked, how do the nerve impulses travel through the neurons? Answer, electrical signals, chemical signals, electrical signals, okay, that is alternate way. You can see here very clearly, this is a first neuron. This arrow shows electrical signals passing, nerve ending. Yellow color here represents the synapse. This is a dendrite of the second neuron. So from here, neurotransmitters carry the signals from this neuron to this neuron. Again here electrical signal starts, it moves here, then there will be a synapse here, converting into chemical signals by neurotransmitters, then it will go to the third neuron and so on. You can see this here, synapse, the gap. So what is a synapse? It's a gap between the two neurons. How are the impulses traveling through the synapse? Answer is because of the neurotransmitters. Next question, how do the impulse travel through the neurons? It is in the form of electrical chemical signals. Okay, so when we learned about from the stimulus to response, we had learned the flowchart starting from stimulus to response, sensory nerves carrying to the spinal cord brain, brain to spinal cord, then from spinal cord to motor. All those actually is this flow of electrical impulses. Clear? So this is just a summary. How does a nervous tissue cause action? Just now when I told you, when I see a glass of water, I'm taking it. So what is the path of that? Information is collected by the sensory neuron. It is carried to the brain. Brain is a central nervous system. And the brain will process the information. And the brain is taking the decision. Here the decision is taken by the brain. And the brain gives a message to the motor nerves, which will pass. These motor nerves are connected to the muscles. And in the muscles are made up of actin and myosin filaments. The contraction and relaxation of those filaments help in the movement. How am I able to move my hand? Because the muscles inside my fingers, it's made up of actin, myosin, they will contract and relax. Clear? So that contraction of proteins is because of the message from the motor nerves. And because of that, there is movement of our limbs. Clear? So this is the path of the normal impulse in our body. Okay, what is reflex actions? See, sometimes you have seen some, when some children come and poke your their finger into your eyes, you suddenly blink. Or you're crossing a road and suddenly a vehicle comes, you jump back. Or you, by mistake, you touch your hand on a hot object. And before you realize that you have withdrawn your hand, before you realize, you've already withdrawn. After withdrawing your hand, you realize, oh, I have withdrawn. That is, your realization is coming after the action. So such actions which is very fast, automatic, is called as reflex actions. Okay? Here. What is a reflex action? It's a rapid, very fast, automatic. Means you did not realize. Okay? Involuntary response. It's not under your control. It's to a stimulus. There was a stimulus. The object was hot. That was a stimulus. But before you realize, you have taken your hand back. So that action is called as reflex action. If someone comes and blinks, shows a torch into your eye, you blink first, isn't it? So that is also a reflex action. See other examples of reflex action: withdrawing your hand from a hot object, coughing. You won't be able to, after coughing you will think, acha, you realize you have coughed, something enters into your nose, you sneeze fast. So that is a reflex action. Sometimes you may not get time to take out a kerchief, by the time you might have sneezed also. Then removing the leg by stepping on a pin. You are walking with, on barefoot, you stepped on a nail or a pin and you just jerk back. So these are all reflex actions. Blinking of the eye, everything. These are all reflex actions. Why is it called reflex action? That's what we are going to see. Why is it called reflex action? See here, we are taking one example of a reflex action. You touched a hot object, the stimulus. It is received by the receptors of your skin. That message passes through the sensory neuron to the spinal cord, children. And what is not present here? Brain is not there. And from the spinal cord this takes the decision, and then it is coming back through the motor neuron, and response is taken by the, done by the muscles of your hand. So since the decision was taken by the spinal cord in emergency situations, suppose in your school, the classes are going on, suddenly you can see that your switchboard in your class, fire is coming out. Do you go and report? Does the teacher go and report to the principal, ma'am, and then she will decide what to do and you will go move out of the class? Will you do like that? No. That time the teacher will take the proper decision. She will just vacate the class. She will tell all the children to move because it is a dangerous situation. It's an emergency situation, but later on she will go and tell it to the principal. Similarly, in emergency situation, decision is taken by the spinal cord, and but later on it will go to the brain. That is why we realize that we have done this reflex action. Clear? So it's involuntary fast reflex action. Why is it required? Why is it required? It is saving us from dangerous accidents. Otherwise your hand might have got lot of burns. So these actions, or when you are going in a road and a vehicle is coming, if that reflex action did not happen, you would have met with an accident. So reflex action help us to save again or from dangerous injuries. Clear? So what is the path of the reflex arc? This is asked in the exam. Path of the reflex action, you can see this heat, it is taken by the thermoreceptors of the hand, sensory neuron to the spinal cord. You can see this neuron, this is a relay neuron. That is, this relay neuron is a neuron between the sensory and the motor nerve. Just like relay which you do in your sports, okay, exchanging the baton. So the impulses are exchanged here through the relay neuron. Then you have the motor neuron connected to your muscles. You can see the muscle filaments here. And because of the contraction of the muscle proteins, you are able to jerk back your hand. Okay? So here there is no involvement of the brain. This is one of the questions asked in the exam. Trace the path of the nerve impulse. What is the situation given? You get the smell of your favorite food from the kitchen. Biryani mummy bana rahi hai. And you walk towards the kitchen. So what's the stimulus? Smell. That's the smell. And then what is your response? You are walking. So you have to trace the path from the smell. What will be the first step? Smell of the food. That is a stimulus. Second one, who is capturing that? The nose. That is the olfactory receptors of your nose. That's your sensory organ. Then it goes to the olfactory receptors of your nose. Carry to the sensory nerve. Spinal cord. It's a normal nerve impulse. It goes to the brain. The brain gives message to the spinal cord. Spinal cord gives a message to the motor nerve. Then muscles of your leg. And then response. What response? You are moving towards the kitchen. So this entire passing of impulse is because of the nerves or the neurons. Okay. So this is a path of the normal nerve impulse. So such situations can be asked in the exam. Or they can ask you, just tell you to fill up the blank ones. Clear?